everybody. As I was introduced, my name is Anna Moniuszko-Malinowska and I work at the Department of the Infectious Diseases and Neuroinfections of the Medical University in Białystok in Poland. This is the seat of my medical university, which is called the Versal of the North. And this is a very beautiful building, so I invite everybody to come to our small city just to visit it because it's worth. But this trip can have one minus, because the Versal of the North is situated in the forest area where we have a lot of ticks. So you may be bitten by tick and you have to be aware of it. But it has also positive sides because thankful to this, we have a great experience on tick-borne diseases and we can quite well cure them. The title of my talk is Tick-borne encephalitis prophylaxis and consequences of its shortage in Poland. It's a little bit controversial because we don't have shortage of vaccine in Poland. You know that nowadays all the pharmaceutical companies would supply any country with any amount of vaccine just in order to make income, but we have very low vaccination rate. And the reasons of it I will explain you later. So I would like to tell you a little bit about the disease. So tick-borne encephalitis is transmitted by ticks. In Europe, these are Ixodes ricinus ticks, and in Russia, these are Ixodes scapularis ticks. And these are ticks collected from the Versal of the North area, very close to where the medical university has the seat. These are Ixodes ricinus nymphs, and these are Ixodes ricinus adults. They are present not only in the forest, as is commonly known, but they may be met also in the meadows or in the bushes. So even if you go for the walk with your dog, you may be bitten by tick. Ticks have two peaks of the activity. So in early spring and then in the autumn. And what is interesting in the cycle of the tick, that larvae and nymphs have the seasonal activity at the same time. So we can also observe it in the clinic because most of the patients are hospitalized in these months because there are many vectors of the virus. The virus has wide range of the host, so starting from the small rodents and ending at the big mammals such as bisons. The virus belongs to the flaviviridae. They are other close relative of the flaviviridae, which you are maybe more familiar with, like Omsk hemorrhagic fever virus, like looping ill virus, Lagat virus, yellow fever, West Nile, Japanese encephalitis, or Dengue virus. These are all friends of the tick-borne encephalitis virus. There are three subtypes of the virus: Western European subtype, Siberian subtype, and Far Eastern subtype. And these cause mostly meningitis, and these two cause encephalitis, so more severe form of the disease. How many minutes is enough for the tick to infect the human? Only 30 minutes. So we have very short time just to look at our body and to remove the tick. Why is it like this? Because tick-borne encephalitis virus is located in the salivary glands. So when we are bitten by tick, the virus goes immediately. And it's different from Borrelia burgdorferi, which is in the guts. So to be infected with Lyme disease, you need 24 hours for the tick to be attached. And for the virus, you need only 30 minutes. So it's very short time. Tick bite is not the only one way of the transmission. There are also cases described of the foodborne TBE when the patients drink unpasteurized milk of goat or cow, even 25 days after the milking. Moreover, yogurt, cheese, and butter may also be infectious. And even if it's well known that pasteurization completely protects against infection, we still have cases of tick-borne encephalitis after drinking the milk. Which countries has the highest incidence? So it's the Central and East Europe and Russia up to the Japan and China. Here you have another map. So almost all the countries in Europe have the TBE. And this is Poland, Here you have Germany, here Russia, and this is where Białystok is located. And the most dark place is the endemic area for tick-borne diseases. It was interesting situation in 1993 observed in all around the Europe, where the sudden increase of the incidence of tick-borne encephalitis was observed. We still don't know why was it, but the scientists tell about two risk factors. It was the social changes, social economics changes, and also the climate changes. So like the temperature increase, the difference in the humidity, but it's still under the investigation. Who is at the risk of tick-borne encephalitis? There are mostly forestry workers, national parks employees, but also mushroom pickers, berries pickers, hunters, and dog owners. The disease can be manifested in three different forms. Meningitis, the mildest form of the disease, meningoencephalitis, and meningoencephalomyelitis. In Poland, we mostly observe meningitis. In Russia, meningoencephalitis and meningoencephalomyelitis. The patients almost always complain about headache, fever, vomits, and nausea. And in physical examination, we see meningal signs, Oppenheim signs, ataxia, consciousness disturbances, and paresis. There are no specific abnormalities in the laboratory tests, so the typical for the viral infection, erythrocyte sedimentation rate, white blood cells, CRP, and aminotransferase may be elevated, but also not in all patients. So the basic examination is the cerebrospinal fluid examination. We perform the lumbar puncture for each patient with suspicious of the TBE, and when we have the pleocytosis of 5 to 1,000 cells, more or less 100 to 300 cells, when we have lymphocytes predominate, when we have protein concentration a little bit elevated, and normal glucose concentration, then we can suspect the TBE. But only suspect. To confirm it, we are obliged to perform the serological test. So serology is the basic tool to confirm the tick-borne encephalitis. Many scientists tried to use the PCR method in the diagnosis, but it didn't find to be useful. It wasn't found to be useful because the virus is very fast eliminated from the body. There is also no causative treatment, so we only treat patients symptomatically with the anti-edematous drugs, with painkillers, anti-inflammatory drugs, and in some cases steroids, but it's also controversial. Why I'm telling about this disease? Because this disease has serious sequelae, the neurological sequelae and psychiatric sequelae. Neurologic sequelae are met in more than 20% of the patients. These are mostly spinal nerve paralysis, ataxia, disorder of sensitivity, and all the patients with neurological sequelae require rehabilitation, which may last even few years. We also observe in our department untypical courses of the disease, like we saw 3 years ago, Korea-like syndrome in the course of the tick-borne encephalitis. Here are some examples. It was a patient with right lower limb paresis. She was rehabilitated for 2 years, but atrophy of the right lower limb remained. Here, patients with the right brachial plexus paresis, and still the atrophy remained. Another patient with bilateral brachial plexus paresis. And here you can see the great effect of rehabilitation because this patient was totally cured. Another patient with tetraparesis and with cranial nerves paresis. Another one with paresis of the cranial nerves with the horizontal nystagmus and the weakness of the shoulder muscles. We also observe the lesions in the imaging studies. So these are the studies of the patients with tick-borne encephalitis. You can still see the changes here. This is 1 year after the TBE, so the changes are resolving, but still existing. We have also other sequelae. sequelae: deafness, vision impairment, vegetative sequelae, intellectual problems, and psychiatristic problems. And according to one-hour observation, the psychiatristic problems are in more than 20% of patients. And another studies on 687 patients showed that they have problems in 43%. So just please pay attention how big percentage it is. And the patient complain about the cognitive disorders, depression, almost 30%, sleep disorders, and anxiety. Mortality rate in European strain of the virus is 1 to 4%, but in the Siberian, even to 40%. And what we observed, there are mostly people with the chronic or concomitant diseases. Like one our patient was co-infected with Listeria monocytogenes, another one was treated with steroids because of the rheumatoid arthritis, another one was the after the transplantation of kidney, and another of renal. And why TBE is so important? Because it's important from the point of view of travel medicine. European Commission in 2012 published an official decision on the addition of TBE to the list of notifiable disease in the European Union. They also published the report about the implementation of the standard case definition of TBE. They proposed collecting standardized comparable data at all European Union countries. And they also emphasized the need to develop the recommendation for immunization for all the people from Europe and the people traveling to endemic areas of tick-borne disease. There are two ways of prophylaxis: non-specific, so repellents, and specific vaccinations. Who should be vaccinated? So mostly the people who are residing in the areas of the increased risk of the disease, like foresters, soldiers, firemen, border guards, farmers, trainees in the forest areas, but also tourists. And if you look at the list of the countries the vaccination is recommended, almost in all European countries, you can see all European countries. There are two vaccinations in Europe. One is FSME Immune, produced by Pfizer, and another one is Encepur, produced by GlaxoSmithKline. They are both very well, they are highly immunogenic, and what is also interesting that the antibodies produced after the vaccination have the cross response against virus from the Asia. So even if you are vaccinated in Europe, you have the response when you go to Russia or Japan or China. It's administered in the three-step scheme, dose at the zero time point, then 1 to 3 months later, and 9 to 12 months later, and the booster every 3-5 years. It depends on the age and on the exposition. So for example, forest workers are boosted every 3 years. And if there is a need of the rapid immunization, because sometimes we are not aware of the need of the vaccination, that we go somewhere abroad. So for Encepur, there are three vaccines on day 0, 7, 21, and then the booster 12 to 18 months. And for the second vaccination, day 0, 14, and then 5 to 12 months, and booster 12 to 18 months. So even if we are in the shortage of time, we still can get the immunization after before the travel. And this is my last slide, because I know that you are hungry and you want to eat something. So I try to be very quick. This is very sad slide. The slide shows the vaccination rate in Poland. Please pay attention that it's only 1%. And for example, in Austria, it's 87%. Austria is the only one country with the lowest tick-borne encephalitis incidence in the whole Europe, because they have obligatory vaccination. And it's a country which we always tell as an example that the vaccination is very effective. But we were wondering, why is it so low? And we performed the survey in our patients, and they respond that the vaccination cost is it's expensive for them. The one dose, it's like £20, and you need three doses, and it's refunded only for the foresters. So the cost was one of the reasons. And another reason, what was even more sad, that there was a lack of awareness of the disease of vaccination. So most of the patients, even if they live in the endemic area, even if they are taking the ticks very often out of the skin, they were not aware that this disease exists, and what is even worse, that we have the weapon against it. So I would like to finish with this sad conclusion, and would like to ask for the increase of the awareness in our patients and in travelers who are traveling to endemic areas for tick-borne disease. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for a very, very clear and interesting talk. We do have time for a couple of questions. Your lunch is not ready in 5 minutes. So other questions. So in practice then, what can be done to increase awareness against this disease?
We try to perform some campaigns, so advertisement companies. We make, when the season is starting, so in the early spring, we make with the pharmaceutical companies some campaign in the cities. For example, last year in our city, we offered the free first dose of vaccination, and there were massive amount of people, like 1,000 people were vaccinated in one day. So we don't know what was later with these people, because the second and the third dose they had to buy by themselves. So we didn't have any tools to follow them. But we are trying to increase awareness by this kind of the companion. And also in the GP. And also GP, we try to educate the GPs to also increase the awareness in the patients that if they live in the endemic areas or if they are travel, there is a vaccination and that they can use it.
So do you think, Anna, there is something that could be done at European level?
Yes.
The European Commission, to the chief medical officer?
Yes. I think that the more people are aware, the higher probability of success will be. So I think that it's still worth talking about this, and just to show examples that you have psychiatristic, you have neurological sequel which affect your further life. So it's like the best example of the patients who suffer from the complications.
Two questions.
A lot of antiviral encephalitis, immunoglobulins are being used, IVIG.
Yes.
Have you tried tick-borne encephalitis? What kind of experience do you have?
In Europe, it's not recommended anymore. It stopped to be given in the 1990s, because the studies showed that it was not effective. And after this, the people even had more severe symptoms. So still there is no great immunoglobulin after the tick bite, because it would be the great, perfect solution. But I know that in Russia, they still have the immunoglobulin and they give it to the patient.
So the treatment is mostly...
Symptomatic. Sometimes we give the steroids, but only in very severe cases. So for example, if the patient has fever up to 40 for 1 week or had some paresis, then we give dexamethasone. But the opinions of experts are not equivocal. So
what is the duration of sickness in meningitis? How long it lasts?
Because this disease has two courses, two phases. One phase is flu-like symptoms, which are 1 for 5 days. Then the patient feels very well. And then after 2 weeks, you have the neurological phase. Then you have the meningitis encephalitis or meningoencephalomyelitis. And it may be various. We have mostly 2 weeks. So most of the patients are cured after 2 weeks, but sometimes it's even months.
Okay, we've got time. Thank you very much. Try to be brief, please. We've got 2 minutes.
But my question is, why is it that you don't have the prevalence of tick in Africa when you have tick for just developed? That's the evidence that you have high prevalence of that.
You have ticks, but you don't have tick-borne encephalitis virus, because you have ticks in Africa, yes? You don't have the virus. The virus is only in this belt, which I showed you on the map.
Okay, so one last
another chapter, very good issue, what we are fighting for. Because they in Poland, only the forestry workers are protected. And what is also ironic, we had this patient with chorea, so chorea like Huntington disease. He was the forest worker, but not on the, he was employed by the private company, and the private company didn't vaccine him. So it was for us shocking, very shocking, because he was forest worker who was not vaccinated, just because everybody is saving money, and it's a stupid attitude, because now he cannot work.
Okay.
Yeah, our stomach.